Good morning, thank you. I'm here today to tell you a little bit about our research related to the forensic chemistry of drugs of abuse, specifically synthetic drugs of abuse. I'll give you a little bit of background about those kinds of things. And we'll talk a little bit about a couple of our examples from projects that we've done over the last few years, tell you about why we do this, what we do, and why we think it's important. Today's discussion will include a little bit of background about the synthetic drugs of abuse that are a problem certainly in our country, as we're all aware. We'll use a couple of examples from our research, one from the so-called designer category, the synthetic cannabinoids, and one from the dinosaur category, an old drug that's made a new comeback because of its abuse potential. Bath salts was the one. These two categories are the ones that are quite commonly used a great deal these days, or abused a great deal these days. And we'll talk about, again, our research activities related to these kinds of things. A bit of background of the synthetic drug trends. In 2016, the complete year that we have statistics on, over 52,000 Americans died from drug overdoses. That's far more than died from car crashes or gun violence. According to the WHO, from its 102 member countries, 650 new drugs of abuse have come along in the last 7 years. Forensic scientists can simply not keep pace with that kind of growth, that kind of continuing growth. Our work is to attempt to help the forensic scientist in being able to keep up with the analytical signatures of these things that come along. Our activities listed here on this slide include funding from the U.S. Department of Justice, the National Institute of Justice. The work is forensic drug chemistry focused on issues related to forensic sciences. Our areas of emphasis, as we'll talk a little bit about as we go along, are imposter molecules and boundary issues that come along in controlled substance. If you come to the lab, we practice analytical sciences and some synthetic organic chemistry. The rationale for the work: if we consider that clandestine drug development often migrates toward those designer substances that place the chemical just outside the language of the most recent laws that were involved in scheduling those things. Boundary issues are always present when we're dealing with synthetic materials in a way that there are always issues of that sort. Imposter molecules are those things that are not the drug of abuse. Our work does not focus on the drug of abuse, but those imposter molecules whose analytical signatures are such that they are could be misidentified, if you will, from those kinds of situations as the number of possibilities grow in synthetic kinds of materials. As an example, or as a comparison, if we compare natural products, where a plant and its biosynthesis produces all of the molecular scaffolding associated with the secondary metabolites in the plant, that is, the drugs of abuse, or the drugs that are produced by the plant, there's only one shape or one isomer of those kinds of things that are produced. However, in the totally synthetic materials, they can appear in a number of isomeric forms, and those isomeric forms quite often have overlapping analytical signatures, particularly those based on the mass of the materials. This slide is an attempt to show you what I mean by this isomer issue, and that is, if we take this simple molecule on the left of this slide, this alkyl benzene, and through some organic synthesis, simply insert a nitrogen in the appropriate valences into the 9 different unique regions of that molecule, we produce those 9 regioisomeric substances. They have the same mass, so a mass-based analytical procedure will find them equivalent. The two in red, the mass-based analytical procedure will find uniquely similar. because they have a number of overlapping signatures in their mass spectrum. One of those two, the one in the middle, is amphetamine. The other one is not. It's not amphetamine. It's not a controlled substance. It's an imposter molecule. There are only two in this particular case, and being able to differentiate these two is a no-brainer to anyone who is skilled in this art. There are plenty of ways to do that by chromatographic methods. Just two compounds in the case of amphetamine. In the case of methamphetamine, it's not two, it's five. In the case of MDMA, it's not five, it's 10. In the case of some of the more recently controlled substances, such as the synthetic opiates and opioids, it's not 10, it's closer to 20. So that a lot of overlapping analytical signatures to tell the difference between controlled versus non-controlled. This is simply the comparison of the mass spectrum for those two materials that were up there to show you that their fragments are also regioisomeric and therefore have the same masses, and there's a great deal of similarity between those two. Across the top of this slide are the names of the old drugs of abuse that we are accustomed to thinking about: marijuana, cocaine, LSD, opiates, methamphetamine is up there. Across the bottom of the yellow region of that slide are the various new subsets that have come along as designer molecules related to those categories. And those categories are not one molecule. In many cases, they are hundreds of molecules. So that this has become quite complicated. If you're interested, some of the structures for some of those categories are, there's an example there of those. One of our projects over the years has to do with the so-called bath salts, cathinone molecules. Bath salts was simply the name on the container that custom, when custom started dealing with these sorts of things. Cathinone is a naturally occurring product produced by the cot plant in the Middle East. If you watched the movie Captain Phillips, you saw the Somali pirates brewing the tea and chewing the leaves of this plant. But the first member of this category came to the market in the U.S. in the 1960s. It was removed from the market due to its abuse potential, and now it and many of its regioisomers are back on the market for the same reason, of course. All the molecular manipulations that can occur from a molecule like this are listed here. There are a number of them we have sorted through over the course of our work. Many of these substances which have overlapping analytical signatures and therefore require unique analytical methods for differentiation of these things. One of the molecules that has come along as a from that designer kind of study, this one that's called MDPV for short, a substitute for cocaine, totally synthetic material, 10 times more potent than cocaine. Other category where we are working and continue to work has to do with the synthetic cannabinoids. As I said before, this is an area which continues to receive a lot of attention from clandestine chemists to make the next designer modification of this, which would place it just outside the boundaries, as I said, for the legal language. We are working on this one. Cannabinoids have two effects in the mammalian system. One is a legitimate target for actual therapeutic use, that is, its use as a possible anti-inflammatory drug. But there are two receptor sites of action for the cannabinoids, CB1, which is in the central nervous system, responsible for the psychoactive effects of these drugs. CB2 is the anti-inflammatory material. These materials, these synthetic materials, are full agonists at the cannabinoid receptor. THC, the natural occurring drug in the plant, is only a partial agonist. These substances, in many cases, JWH18, five times more potent than THC as an active ingredient. Background in this area, the first placement of a control on any of these substances came along in 2011. The DEA controlled actually five molecules, of which three are these synthetic materials. Today, they're a little over, 6 years later, no one knows exactly how many of these things are around. Hundreds, at least 100. So this is an ever-increasing problem and growing issue. JWH-18 is in the box in the middle of that slide. All of those other imposter molecules are not JWH18. There are methods that are required in order to be able to differentiate among those. And we have spent a great deal of time sorting through those in order to be able to make those differentiations. So what do? We provide a detailed framework of the analytical properties and the relationships to drug structure. And we produce a more scientifically prepared forensic expert to interact in these various places where they have to do that in the legal system and the scientific community. I should acknowledge in closing the support from the National Institute of Justice for our work, and thank you for your attention.